Seminar about innovation, I thought I'd talk a bit about the past. But that is the future of the past, though. You're all familiar with the 404 problem, and actually the first speaker referred to it. You know, the link-rot kind of problem, which also happens in scientific communication. And this is just taken from a recent study with that regard. But so we know that URIs tend to decay over time. What the studies find is that the most vulnerable kind of materials are in what we used to call the periphery of the Scholarly record, computer programs, databases, you know, the peripheral material, which actually, as scholarship evolves, become more core, become really part of the essence of the scholarly record. These kind of studies, though, only tell you part of the problem. The one that I'm going to introduce, I refer to as the current representation problem, and it's related to the fact that the web exists in the eternal now. So this is the web, and these are resources on the web with their URIs, and resources have representations. You dereference a URI, you get something back. Now, these representations change over time. If you visit the BBC website today, you get something different than what you got back yesterday. But the way the web is designed, the way the protocol of the web, HTTP, works, is that any moment in time, you can only get the current representation of a resource back. So that means that even if the links persist over time, what you get back may not necessarily be what was actually originally pointed at. And that's what I call the eternal now, or the current representation problem. So there's a big difference here between the paper-based era and the web-based era. This is the paper-based. You have a publication, and it references some other publications. And you look at that a couple years later, and again, we're still in the paper-based age, and you can completely and faithfully reconstruct that entire context, because you just go to the shelves, you take the cited articles, and you have the entire shebang. Not so in the web-based scholarly communication, because all of these things now exist within a web context. It's not just the material, it's a lot of stuff that sits around it also. And now, as time goes by, that stuff actually evolves. And so, you know, maybe the publication as such remains stable, but the context surrounding these publications is kind of changing. And so that basically means that sometime after the publication, it becomes impossible to reconstruct the version of record, you know, when you consider the context surrounding the publication to be part of the record. And so the question here becomes, or the question that I'm going to talk about today, is it actually possible to reconstruct the temporal context that exists around the publication as it was at the time that the thing was actually published? Okay, I think being able to do that is going to become increasingly important as scholarly communication becomes more web native. Rather than, you know, using the desktop metaphor of PDFs, when all scholarship is going to be web native, it's going to become extremely important to be able to recreate temporal context of the scholarly record. So traces of the web of the past actually exist out there. I'm sure you've heard of web archives, such as the Internet Archive, content management systems that have good version mechanism, of course, keep traces of the past. Even search engine caches have a short-term memory of very recent web past. But that stuff is not very well integrated in the web itself. I'll give you an example. This is from Wikipedia. And actually, if you want to go back to an old version of that page, you need to browse the history tab. And depending on how controversial or active a topic is, it can take you a couple of minutes to go to a version as it exists at a certain moment in time. And also, you can't consistently navigate in time. When you are at an old version, as we are here, and we have a pointer to another page in Wikipedia that describes the Pentagon, when you navigate that, you actually arrive again at the current page, not at the version as was active when this was active. So you don't have real time travel experience. That's where a project that I've been working on recently comes in. It's called Memento. And Memento allows you to, Memento is an extension of the HTTP protocol, okay? And it allows you to dereference a URI, in this case, the one from Apple, subject to time. So you now have in your browser a little plugin, allows you to choose a moment in time, and the URI apple.com is dereferenced subject to time. And all of that goes automatically. It's protocol based. The way it works, I'm not going to get too technical, but basically, a current resource, if this is the current URI, cnn.com, and if these are archived versions thereof, we put some resource in between, which we call a time gate. This is Star Trek, right? And basically, this resource can point to its time gate, and the time gate knows about the old versions of the thing. And here, at this time gate, you can negotiate content negotiation in HTTP for a version for a specific moment in time. And so that allows you to use the original URI to actually end up at the version as it existed at a certain moment in time. The other way around, when you end up at an old version, it also becomes possible to traverse to the original URI. That's the Memento framework. This is being standardized via the IETF. There's lots of tools out there. Web archives are starting to implement Memento natively. All right, let me go back to recreating the temporal scholarly record context. I took a paper that I wrote. It's one that fits well with this audience, Rethinking Scholarly Communication, Building the System that Scholars Deserve. It's a very popular paper with librarians, not with this audience, I think. And so I picked it for a reason. It's one of those papers that cites a lot of material on the web. So you see all these URIs out there. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to look at some of these citations. So the first one is to Dan Atkins' Cyber Infrastructure Report. And I'm going to dereference that, and the domain is gone. But now we use Memento, and we end up in a web archive with a version of December 2003. Remember, this thing was published somewhere in 2004, if I'm not mistaken. Yep. All right, so that was this one. I think the next one, which is Tim Brody, it's something from the Southampton group. And this is the current version. It's still there, so the link works. But I want a version of some time in the past, at the moment of publication. I use Memento, and I get an archived copy out of the Internet Archive here. Next one up, Clifford Lynch, a paper about institutional repositories. Whoops, that's from the ARL. It's gone. But of course, Memento helps you to find an archived copy. And then this one by Sandy Piet and Tony Staples. Resource is totally gone. And unfortunately, not even an archived copy anywhere. And then the last one, Rosendahl and Goertz. This paper about forces and function in scholarly communication. This is the current one. We use Memento, and we're able to go back in time and find a version of around the time it was published. Now, this is anecdotal, of course. I just showed you a little paper of mine and citations therein. We did the study of this at large scale. We took all the papers from the physics archive and some papers from an institutional repository and extracted all the cited URIs there, ending up with about 150,000 URIs for which we did this kind of exercise. One, do the URIs still exist? Two, do we have archived versions thereof? Three, do the archived versions somehow are close temporally in time to the publication date of the citing paper? And this is published, so you can look up that paper if you want. Here we see this is for the University of Northern Texas Institutional Repository. Links that still exist and stuff is archived. Links, the link doesn't work anymore, but there's something archived. Still exists, but nothing is archived. Link doesn't work anymore, and nothing is archived. And a similar kind of picture for the physics archive, with lots of stuff again here that is not archived and the link doesn't exist. And here exists but is not archived, so that's all a danger of vanishing, you know, when these links break. Even more interesting is, I think, this picture. And I want you to focus on this part here, month percent. What this shows is the percentage of linked things for which an archived version exists in a temporal span of a month after publication of the citing paper. Okay? So rather good here, but hardly anything there. And when you look at the physics archive, the situation is even much more dramatic. So what you see is that basically for less than 10% of the things that are being cited, is there an archived copy in a span of a month around the time of publication of the thing that cites them. So the point here really is you cannot recreate the temporal context. Even though Memento as a technology would allow you to go to those old versions, the old versions simply do not exist. Now, I skipped one here deliberately, and it's one that is identified by means of a DOI, because I see some people in the audience think, well, that's why we have DOIs, right? Well, unfortunately, DOIs don't really solve this problem either. So here's what DOIs do, the HTTP version thereof, right? HTTP version of a DOI, it redirects in a certain time frame to this resource up there. And then later on, that changes, right? And we're now redirecting to this one, and later again, we're redirecting to that one. That's, you know, what DOIs do. And so, of course, all of these resources here can have old versions, so there can be time gates for them, so we could apply Memento to all of that to travel back in time. So let's do that. And let's presume that we're looking for an old version for a time between T2 and T3, which was when things were redirecting here. Now, of course, a client that goes in today, the only thing it sees is the current situation, which brings you here. So what it is going to do, it is going to follow this path and is going to try and find an old version for that one. But of course, that means you end up at the wrong version, right? Because this is the one that you wanted. But this link is not available. It's invisible to the client. So what you really would want is that at the level of the DOI resolver or so, there is some history of redirection. And now I could, you know, talk to the DOI resolver and say, I'm not interested in the current, but in an old version. And so you could reconstruct that path. And as a matter of fact, then end up at the appropriate old version, of course, if it's archived somewhere. Unfortunately, however, I checked with the people at CNRI who are doing the DOI resolver. The history of redirects is not available. It is not being maintained. So the only thing that the DOI resolver knows about is where it's redirecting today, not where it redirected yesterday, let alone be last year. Okay? So while DOIs help indeed to basically make sure that the link does not break, they are not of a big help to allow us to travel back into the past. Add to that that the pages to which the DOIs resolve, so the splash pages and all, are typically not even being archived because crawlers cannot get into them because of very restrictive robot.txt situations. And so what you get there is, again, the DOI that lives in the eternal now, just like the entire web does, and doesn't really help a lot in reconstructing the scholarly temporal context. So to conclude, we have been very good with efforts like Portico, Locks, Clocks, the Keepers Registry, to start archiving the assets of the typical journal system. We are not doing a good job at all at stuff in the periphery that I think will become much more important over time as scholarship evolves. So we need to start thinking about actively archiving that kind of material also. For example, at the time of publication, dereference the citations, archive these things, use things like website, you know, like certain publishers do. I think we should start seriously thinking about maintaining the history of DOI and Perl's redirects also, in order to be able to do time travel across these kind of links also. Web archives and content management systems with good versioning approaches can play a significant role in this problem domain. And Memento, as I think I've tried to show you, and you can try it for yourself by installing a browser plugin called Memento Fox, can help to do these traversals over time and to effectively reconstruct temporal context. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Herbert. We have time for a couple questions.
Thank you very much, very interesting. Is the problem actually not much bigger than you describe here? Because what I see from my laptop might not even be the same that you see at the same second from your laptop. And actually that's all not concluded or not included in here. And I think that is over time going to be, especially if we talk about context, more and more of a problem.
Yep, I actually very much agree with that. But see, we live in the situation currently where the archiving part is absolutely imperfect. And what you're talking about is the other extreme where the archiving is absolutely perfect and is actually at the level of individual experiences. There's a whole continuum in between there. And what I'm trying to do here is to move gradually forward. Okay? I cannot promise you a world where everything is being archived, right? When we look at the past of the web, it's always spotty. You know, even with the web archives, Internet Archive, British Library Archive, it's all spotty. You know, I'm not claiming here that we need a perfect recreation of history, but especially I think for the scholarly record, you know, where version of record and things like that matter a lot, I think we should pay more attention to archiving not only the core assets, but also the things that are linked off it. But of course, I agree with you.
Okay, now, there is another question. Could I ask you, when before you ask the question, to introduce yourself? And the first question was from, and my apologies for mispronouncing, Eidsbrand Jan Albersberg from Elsevier.
Tony Fonderson from the European Patent Office. Is it possible for you to use Memento to work backwards? That is, if you're given a database of scholarly records and dates on which those records were actually present on the web, can you use Memento to do what you've just demonstrated?
Memento works at the level of HTTP URIs. So as long as things are identified by HTTP URIs, and as long as those things are being archived, Memento can do its thing. Okay, but it works at the level of HTTP, so you need an HTTP URI that identifies something in order to be able to do the time traversal. And of course, the systems, the archival systems in which these things reside have to be made Memento compliant. It doesn't just work by itself. They need to support the protocol.
Time for one more if there's another questioner. If not, thank you again, Herbert.
Thank you.